I invite your attention this morning to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 4. We were there a couple weeks ago when we talked about uncertainties. Uncertainties. I will use that text plus some others this morning to continue that series concerning uncertainties. And by the way, you could pretty much wrap up anything and everything in this life under uncertainties. Amen?
Amen.
And this morning we're going to talk about certainties. And you could pretty much wrap up everything in the Bible and from the Lord from heaven as certain. So I'm going to use that text again. We were interrupted last week because we did an Easter message on the resurrection. But I want to return to this text. I want to review and continue. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to read verse 17 and 18. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal way of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. The things which are seen are not certain. The things which are seen are certain. We look at the things that are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. I'm going to ask Brother Dalton, if you will, to stand and lead us in prayer, please.
Dear Lord, thank you this morning for the privilege of prayer. Thank you for answered prayer and for being good to us in so many ways. Thank you for saving us through the blood of Jesus Christ and keeping us, supplying the things we have need of, Father. We thank you for the privilege we have to be a part of this church. Thank you for each member. Thank you for Brother George for his ministry here, for Miss Pat for her health that you have seen fit to return to her health, and Lord, for her dedication to the children and helping them. Lord, we thank you for our visitors this morning. Thank you for sending them our way, and we pray your blessings upon each one together. May your Holy Spirit direct our lives and help us to live a greater life for the cause of Christ. Forgive our sins and our failures. Bless all these on the prayer list. Make us a blessing to thee and to others is my prayer in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. We're living in a society and in a world and in a nation that pretty much centers all of its intention on now. More stuff, beauty, fame, fortune. Everything is for now. The commercials on the television encouraging us to lay in store for old age are manifold. There's very little, if any, attention paid to the next life. That's a bad mistake. That's a bad choice. We looked at some uncertainties according to the Word of God. And by the way, everything that the world puts a stamp of certainty and a sure thing about, stamp of sure, the Bible says it's not sure. If you'll remember, we talked about the uncertainty of beauty, Psalm 39:11. When thou wert rebuked, dost correct man for iniquity, thou makest his beauty to consume away like a moth. Every man is vanity. The beauty cream industry in America is a multi-billion-dollar industry. And ultimately doesn't work. Amen? Now, I knew I wouldn't get any on that one. The women didn't want to hear it, the men are scared to say amen. And so this we can all say amen. Men's promises, Psalms 146:3. Put not your trust in princes, nor in the Son of Man, in whom there is no help. We are in a year of the political convention. Anybody hear that on TV lately? That's all we hear. All the promises of what we're going to do. And you know what they're going to do? None of it. And then there's the promise of riches. Proverbs 23:5. Wilt thou set thine eyes upon that which is not? For riches certainly make themselves wings. They fly away as an eagle toward heaven. Everything you've got either will fly away, and if it doesn't, you're going to fly away. You will take nothing. And then what about our hopes of the future? Proverbs 27:1. Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. Amen.
Amen.
We have today. Yesterday's gone. You don't have tomorrow. If God chooses to give it to you, you'll have tomorrow, and it'll be today. But right now, all you have is today. As a matter of fact, all you have right now is the one breath that you're breathing right now. The future. Only God knows the future. We don't. And then what about friendship? Jesus Christ said in John 16:32, that the world is not our friend. And David took that a step farther in Psalms 55. He said the very people that I went to church with turned against me. And the Lord reminds us, He will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And then there's our very life. And yet it says it's appointed unto man once to die. And James said, what is your life? It's a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Truly the man who said this said the right thing. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. And then earthly glory. Oh my goodness. How we promote Hollywood. How we promote the movie stars. How we promote sports personalities. Folks, that's just for a little while. That's for a very little while. 1 Peter 1:24 says, for all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man is the flower of the field, the grass thereof. The flower thereof shall fall away. Shall fall away. There is nothing in this life that is certain. Nothing in this life. But folks, I have good news for you today. Because I'm going to preach to you about comforting certainties. God made some promises in the Bible. And He said in Titus 1:2, He cannot lie. What God promised, He will do. We sing, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Now, what does the Bible say about certainties? And when the Bible says something is certain, you can rest on it. It will not fail you. Let me begin by saying the promises of God are certain. We've all had people make promises, and they didn't keep them. They couldn't, they never meant to, or they did, but ultimately it never happened. God will never do that to you. The promises of God are certain. 1 Kings 8:56. Blessed be the Lord God that hath given rest unto his people according to all that he promised. There hath not failed one word of all his good promise. Do you get that? There hath not failed one word of all his good promise. Did he say he would save you? He did. Did he say he would feed you? He does. Did he say he would get you out of trouble? He has. Did he say he would never leave you? He hasn't left you. Did he say at the end of his life he'd take you to glory? He will. There hath not failed one good word of all of God's promises. You can trust the Bible. The promises are sure. Your life as a Christian is based on a sure foundation. Your life as a Christian will never fail. The car you drive will get old and get rusty and break down. Friends will leave you. The house you live in is going to get old and fall down. The body you live in is going to get old and break down. But here is a foundation. Isaiah 28:16. Therefore thus saith the Lord God, I lay in Zion a foundation, a stone, a sure stone, a precious corner stone, a sure foundation. You know who that is? That's a person. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And that is his word. And that are his promises. And that is his heaven. The invisible is more sure, more solid, more enduring than the visible. Jesus Christ. You build your life on Christ. You build your life on his word. You build his life. You build your life on his promises. And your life will be sure. The very nature of the life of a righteous person is a sure life built upon a sure foundation. Everything else is sinking sand. Everything, everything, everything in this life is sinking sand. You have with God a sure reward. Men make promises to you. You get all these things in the mail promising you free vacation, free car, free trip, free money, free this, free that. Where is it? Where is it? It's not. It makes itself wings. But Jesus said in Matthew 10:42, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. You invest your life in Christ, your reward is sure. Benefiting in this life, blessed in the next. And then, what about love? Divine love. Romans 8:38-39. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor power, nor things present, nor things to come, nor anything shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Life on this planet is a life of requited love. Husbands walk out of a marriage. Ladies walk out of a marriage. children who grow up and refuse to honor their parents. Grandchildren who care nothing about their grandparents. You've given your love, you've given your all, and somewhere, somehow, someway, someone has broken your heart. Requited love. Folks, we have a Lord that will never do that to you. He has loved you from all eternity. He has loved you from before the foundation of the world. He loves you now no matter what. He will love you into eternity. He will love you through all eternity. He has a love for you that you cannot outlive, outstrip, outdo, or undo. A certainty is the love of Christ. And then here's something else that's certain. Your immortality. We as Bible-believing Christians, we do not believe dead as a dog. Yes, the body dies, goes back to the grave, but God will give you another one when he comes. Amen. Death is not even a word used for Christians. Death is a word in the Bible used for unbelievers. The word for death used for believers in the Bible is sleep. That is much more correct than death. Because when the body dies, which it will do, you who live in the body are released into the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will have more life than you ever thought about having here. 2 Corinthians 5:1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, that's our body, we have a building of God. This body is called a tent because it's temporary. The next body is called a building because it's solid and it will stand the test of eternity. We have a building of God. And house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Eternal in the heavens. And so, the assured immortality, God cannot lie, reserved a place for you. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place, I'm going to come again. And I'm going to receive you unto myself. That where I am, there ye may be also. Death is not the enemy of a Christian. Death, the dying of the body, is a friend to a believer. I am now taking half a day, once a week, going to Harris Hospital, downtown Fort Worth. My longest friendship on this planet, a missionary, pastor friend of mine, is dying. He's 83 years old. We met in 1962. Quit laughing back there. Yes, that's before dirt. I admit it. Yes. But I've been a good friend of this man and vice versa all these years. And he's dying. He's had a full life. She had a good life. Good life of Christian service. Healthy till about 2 weeks ago. I mean healthy till about 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago. He fell. You know, when you get in your 70s and 80s, we've all known one fall can change the rest of your life. Well, it did for him. And you'll soon be going home. But that's a good thing for a Christian. What would it be if you got so sick you could not die? That would be awful. No, death is a sweet release for the believer to go into the eternal presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is the promise of immortality is a promise that God makes and will keep. And then I'm going to give you one more. And that is eternal anchorage. We sang the first song this morning that we sang. It talks about an anchor. And we all know what an anchor is. Ships, boats, all have anchors that drop down and hold the ship, hold the boat steady. Christ is our anchor. Hebrews 6:19, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast. Anchor, sure, steadfast. Folks, everything in this life will fail, but your Christianity will not fail. Your Lord will not fail. The promises of the Word of God will not fail. You anchor your soul to Christ. You live your life by the Holy Scriptures, and you will not fail, thus saith the Word of God. Last week, uncertainties. This week, certainties. Folks, next week, sobering certainties. Application. I love the theme song of the late Dr. J. Vernon McGee because it sums this up in one neat little statement. The song says, how firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he hath said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled. Amen. Would you stand, please? With their bowed, with their eyes closed. The musicians are coming. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I want to ask you a question this morning. What are you building your life on? The Lord said if you build it on anything other than the Lord and His Word, you're building on sand. And the storm's going to come and blow your life away. You only have one life. It's a trust from God. What are you living your life for? Or are you, as the Lord commands us, you've received Him as your Lord, your Savior, your Master. Your life is committed to Him. You're studying and praying and growing in the grace of God and living your life for the Lord. That's building on a rock. That's building on a foundation. That's building a life that will stand not only for time, but eternity. I plead with you in the name of our glorious Lord Jesus Christ. Build your life on the rock of Jesus Christ. It will stand. If you need to receive Christ this morning, I want to invite you to step out and come forward. You would like to become a member of our church this morning as we receive members in this place. I invite you to step out and come forward. If I can pray with you this morning, I invite you to come. If you just want to come here and kneel on the front pew and pray, you are welcome to do that. We're going to sing after I pray. Our precious Heavenly Father, bless this invitation. Have your will and way, please, in every heart, mind, and life for their good. And for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray this. Amen. We're singing number
123.
Number 123. Sing with us. If the Lord leads you, you come and respond.